Hello, my name is Alan Jones. I give you a very warm welcome to Life Stories, coming to you live from Life Stories Worldwide. We are live on Zoom, Facebook, YouTube, and StreamYard, but you can also watch on our website, lifestoriesworldwide.com. Watch directly on there. We encourage you to go to our website and look at all the information that's on there. We encourage you to share it with others. You can go to our YouTube channel, Life Stories Worldwide. There you can see many, many stories. I encourage you to pass them on to others and to press the subscription button. Today we have a story coming to you from Texas in the USA. And it gives me a great pleasure to invite our speaker, Dr. Joshua Fowler, to come. He is a revivalist and a reformer. He's had a rich history of ministry. He has been preaching the gospel for over 36 years, been into 37 countries, written many books, and he has a wonderful story to tell. So I'm going to hand over now to Joshua. Thank you, Joshua.
Such an honor to be with you today, Alan, all of you at Life Stories. Just an honor to share the word of God with you and share my testimony. You know, the Bible lets us know we're an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. So I just want to admonish those of you that are watching today, be ready in season and out of season to share your testimony, because you never know whose life you'll touch and who you'll see changed for the glory of God. As Alan shared earlier, I'm a fifth generation preacher. I was never going to do this. I had my mind made up. I was going to be a businessman, support the church, maybe sit on the back row, give money to help see the kingdom of God advance, but I wasn't going to speak. I wasn't going to preach and do what I'm doing now for the past 36 years. Never say never. I can tell you that as soon as I told the Lord I'll do whatever, whenever, however, the Lord changed my life. Now, as I said, I was raised as a PK. That's preacher's kid, for those of you that don't know that language. And so I was one of those preacher's kids that maybe wasn't so good. There were times in my life that I strayed and that I ran from the Lord. I was partying. I was living unrighteously, doing things I shouldn't be doing, trying to fill that void in my life. You see, I grew up in church, but I had saw that there was a lot of religiosity and not as really as many true relationships as many people professed. And so I was a little bit bitter and grew a little bit disconnected with the church because I saw people that were not living what they preached. And my parents, as ministers, as leaders of the gospel, they were a lot of times taken advantage of or hurt, standing, loving the flock, loving the sheep, and then people would hurt them. And so I kind of strayed. I pulled away from things. My father had an airplane crash. You heard me right. He had an airplane crash. He was a evangelist, and he still is. And I traveled with him all my life from when I was a week old all the way until he had the airplane crash when I was 15. We would go from city to city, state to state, preaching the gospel. Well, when I was 15, he had this airplane crash. And so because he couldn't catch me, that's when I began to stray away and begin to run from my calling and run from the ways of the Lord. But I can remember it like it was yesterday. December the 15th, 1987, everything changed. Just about a month prior to this, I had injured my knee in a basketball football game. I tackled a guy on the 50-yard line, and my knee at the joint went completely 90 degrees, my leg did, and it ended all of my dreams and aspirations for sports and for scholarships that I had already been told I would have. So I was just at rock bottom, and I still continued to pursue things wrong and do things wrong and live ungodly because I felt like I'd lost everything. So now I'm just going to just go and sin rights, the way I would call it. If I sin, I might as well go ahead and go all in. So in the process of doing that, I hit rock bottom even further I was caught out one night partying. My dad, being a minister in the town, somebody let him know that I was out. And when I came home, he took my keys from my car, and then he just sent me to the room. He was so upset with me. He didn't even want to deal with me right then, because he was worried what he would do if he did. So I went to my room. I remember I got up the next day. I was weeping. I was sad. And I walked through the living room, and my mom was weeping and crying, and my dad was mad at me, and just couldn't believe that his son was out partying. His son was out living ungodly, because now I'd been caught. And so this went on for a number of weeks, and my heart eventually began to soften. And one night, it was a Tuesday night service at a little church called Victory Tabernacle Assembly of God. My dad was the pastor of the church. Service was over. Everybody left. We met in a gymnasium for our services. And I asked my dad, I said, "Dad, can I just stay here?" And he said, "Sure." And I said, "I'll lock up." I had a key to the gym because I would always go and play. My dreams were to be an NBA basketball player, and now they were shattered. So service was over, everybody left, the lights were off. I was in this cold gymnasium, December the 15th, 1987. And I went over and I knelt down by the basketball court, right between the basketball court and the platform that we had for our sanctuary where we had service. There was a speaker box, and I can remember nestling in between the speaker and the line there on the basketball court line and the platform. I knelt down. There was nobody there. There was no worship music, nobody to pray for me. But I just had my time with the Lord. And I told the Lord that I was sorry. And I told the Lord, I said, "Tonight, I'm getting married to you. Not as the marriages of this world that come and go."
Life Stories Worldwide is on YouTube, and it's very easy to subscribe to our channel. Just click the bell and subscribe and receive notifications of when we are live, or simply watch any of our other videos. So check it out and give us a visit.
"But I'm going to be married to you, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, and in death we won't part." And I said, "Jesus, I'm yours. I'm married to you. From this day forward, I'm yours." That was the language that a 16-year-old kid had come from his heart that bubbled out that night. And I remember getting up off of my knees and pointing at the ground with this authority that I'd never had before. And I pointed at the ground as if the enemy, as if Satan was right there in front of me. I pointed at him and I said, "Devil, whatever you got, you can bring it on, but I will get up. I will get up. If I fall flat on my butt, I'll brush myself off. And from this day forward, I'm going for Jesus." Because see, like I said earlier, before then, every time I would mess up as a teenager, as a child, I would just say, "Well, I've blown it. I might as well go ahead and keep going further." And I go further and further, whether it was drugs or alcohol or womanizing or whatever it was, I just go further with it. But this night I got a determination in my spirit once I got married to God. And I said, "Devil, bring it on. You bring it. I'm going to go for the Lord, and I'll brush myself off if I fall, and I'll get right back up and follow the Lord." All my friends on my football team, my basketball team, everybody, they couldn't believe it, because I had been partying with them and living this lifestyle. And they said, "Oh, you're going to last 2 weeks." Well, 2 weeks turned into three, and 3 weeks turned into months, and months turned into years. And now here it is. Just a few days from now, I will celebrate 36 years that I have been walking with Jesus. And I can tell you, just like my granddaddy that preached 70 years would say, it gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a joy between the Lord and I. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. So I have fallen. I have made mistakes. I have to be honest with you. I've had to confess my sins. I've fallen. I've busted. If you saw me in the spirit, you might see some asphalt in these cheeks or in these elbows spiritually or on my knees for making mistakes. But I've kept that commitment from with the Lord from that time forward that, hey, I'm going to get right back up if I make a mistake, brush myself off, and get up and live for the Lord. You know, the Word of God lets us know, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. There is therefore now no condemnation. Say that with me. There is therefore now no condemnation. That's the key. There is therefore now no condemnation. So if you mess up, the Bible lets us know that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The Word of God lets us know that he washes us with his word. He washes us with his blood. So there is power in your confession. So before, as I said, I would fall and I would just keep falling and stay down and live in that muck. But now, over these past 36 years, I found myself being able to stand and walk and keep moving forward in the Lord. And if I busted occasionally, I get right back up. And you know what's beautiful about our Daddy God? Our Abba Father, he's more loving than we are with our children. I've got 6 children. And he's more loving than we are with our natural children. In fact, he said, if you ask your father for a piece of bread, he won't give you a stone. And if you ask him for fish, he won't give you a serpent. How much more will your heavenly Father not give you good things when you ask for it? He'll give it, give you what you ask for. He'll bless you concerning the Holy Spirit and everything. The Bible lets us know every good gift comes from above, from the Father of lights. So every good gift comes. And so instead of, if you ever make a mistake, instead of running from him, run to him, because he's right there, ready to pick you up. I think about it this way. My oldest child is 30, and I can remember when he started walking, my son Hunter. I never, when he fell, went over to him and said, oh, you dummy, just stay down. I can't believe you messed up. No, I would go over and help him up and encourage him to keep walking. Now, my 25-year-old twin daughter is the same way. When they were learning to walk, I did the same thing. With my son that I adopted from Taiwan, who's now 17, I adopted him when he was 2. When he was learning to walk and learning to do things as a child because he had some special needs, I didn't just push him down when he fell, but as a loving father, I went and picked him up. That's what our Daddy God, our Abba Father, does for us. If we fall, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He'll pick you up right where you fall. And you know what's amazing to me? Have you ever watched a race? If you've watched somebody run in a race, if they fall, they don't run back to the beginning of the race and start running. No, they get back up right where they fell and they keep running forward. Many times as believers, if we fall, we think we got to go back to the beginning, go through everything over again, but that's not how it is. He wants you just, if you've made a mistake, maybe you're a man of God, a woman of God, maybe you were in the church years ago and you've backslidden, you've fallen away. He wants you to get up right where you fell and reach your hands towards him, and he'll pick you up and he'll cause you to move back forward into this race that he has given us. This race of life. You know, it's not the one who runs the swiftest. It's the one who endures till the end. So if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all. What part of all do you not understand? All unrighteousness. Doesn't matter how bad it was, what you did, he's able to wash you white as snow. In fact, the Bible says, though your sins be as scarlet, they'll be washed white as snow. He'll wash you. And in fact, he'll cast your sin as far as the east is from the west. He'll forget them. He'll remember them no more. Think about that. There is no line of demarcation of where the east and the west begin. It continues. He said, I'm going to throw it so far that you'll never find it.
Life Stories Worldwide is broadcast live every Monday night at 8 p.m. UK time. We broadcast on YouTube, Facebook, and StreamYard. Why not join us every Monday night at 8 p.m. UK time for Life Stories Worldwide.
Hallelujah. I'll cast it into the sea of forgetfulness. Now think about that, what I shared with you earlier. Think about that. There is therefore now no condemnation. Say, this is now. Declare that right now. This is now. Now, whatever you did wrong, when you ask forgiveness from Christ, you say, that was then and this is now. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh. All you have to do is just throw your hands up and say, Daddy, just pick me up. Just pick me up. Daddy, I'm here. And your Abba Father will pick you up. You just come to him in the name of Jesus and he'll wash you white as snow. Just say, I'm sorry. Just forgive me. And then he'll pick you up and he'll wash you. And it will be as if it never happened. In fact, the Word of God lets us know that whosoever sins we remit, they'll be remitted. And so in a few minutes here, I'm going to pray for you a powerful prayer. You're going to pray. You're going to ask the Lord into your heart. And I'm going to stand in proxy with the Lord and with these other brothers that have joined us tonight on this live broadcast. And we're going to declare and come in agreement with you that your sins have been remitted. That even as you profess it, as you confess it, as you declare he is Lord, you're going to be set free tonight. Boy, that's powerful. December 15th, 1987, rocked my world, changed me forever. 12 days later, get this, 12 days later, the Lord visited me personally. He came to me, lifted me up into the heavens. I know there's people that don't believe in this, but it's all right. The man with an argument is always at mercy of the man with an experience. I've had an experience. I've had an encounter with the Lord. The Lord came into my room, lifted me up past the ceiling, into the heavens, into this place with him. You know, Ephesians chapter 2 says that you and I are seated with Christ in heavenly places. One translation says we're co-seated. So he took me up to this place with him in the heavenlies in this encounter. And he began to show me things to come. 12 days later, a teenager who never knew any of this, never experienced any of this, but he took me up on my words. You remember I said, I'll do whatever, whenever, however you want me to do it. In fact, I was so stirred, I'd never written a song, but when I was walking home that night, or crutching home, because I had crutches and I had a cast up to my thigh, as I was crutching all the way to the parsonage, I began to sing, I'll do whatever, however, whenever the Lord wants. I'll do whatever, however, whenever the Lord wants. All you have to do is show me your direction and truth. I'll do whatever, however, whenever the Lord wants. Yeah, that's the first song the Lord ever gave me. And it came up out of the heart of this teenager after giving my life to the Lord on December the 15th, 1987, getting married to the Lord. I began to tell him, I'll do whatever, whenever, however. Would you do that today? Just tell him, I'm yours, Lord. I'll do whatever, whenever, however. I can tell you, he took me up on it. I said, I would never preach. I wouldn't be doing this. And now here it is, 36, almost 36 years later, 37 nations later, preaching this gospel. I said I would never go to nations because I was worried that I was going to have to eat some kind of strange food. They would cook me in some part of the world, and I'm a meat and potatoes kind of guy. And now I've been to 37 nations, and I love it. I said I would never prophesy because I told my mom, I said, I don't want to mess with people's souls. And now that's one of the main things the Lord uses me to do, to speak into people's destiny, to encourage them, to give God love letters to his people through prophecy. And so, as I said, 12 days later, he lifted me up, he took me up on that word, and he began to show me things for me personally. You know, the word of God lets us know in Jeremiah 29 that he has a hope and a future for each of us. He has an expected end. He began to show me that he had a hope and a future for me, an expected end. He began to show me that he wished above all else, according to 3 John 2, that I be in health and prosper as my soul prospers. He began to show me that I was more than a conqueror. He began to speak to me, and I began to spend time in his word. And as you give your life to the Lord, that's one of the primary things you can do. You say, Joshua, how do you know the voice of God? You spend time in his word. You spend time and get to know the one who wrote this love letter to you. When you begin to know the word, you begin to know his voice. Every rhema must line up with the logos. Every vision, every encounter, everything that you ever experience, it needs to line up with the word of God. You know how I can know that God speaks through dreams? Because the word of God declares in Job, I believe it's chapter 35, that he seals our instructions with dreams. I can see that he spoke throughout scripture to different leaders through dreams. You know how I know that he speaks through visions? Because he gave Paul a vision. He gave visions and dreams throughout the word. Do you know how I can hear his voice and speak with precision the prophetic word of the Lord? Because I see that he did that with people in this book. And as I read this book, I find that we are still living in this New Testament age. We're still living in the flow of the Holy Spirit. In fact, he gave us the Holy Spirit so that we could know the voice of God. He said, my sheep know my voice, and another they will not follow. He said, I'm giving you this comforter, the Holy Spirit, so that he will remind you of my ways, that he'll lead and guide you into all truth. So when you spend time in the word and you begin to have fellowship with the Lord, with the Holy Spirit, then you begin to know his voice, and another you won't follow. You begin to grow in that relationship. So God began to just totally wreck me, change me, totally mold me and remake me. I went to BBC. That was the first Bible college I went to, Bedroom Bible College. I spent time and I got a degree in neology. I ate carpet. I prayed. I spent time with the Lord. I cried, spent time with him. I spent time in his word, and he began to show me visions and dreams and give me things from his word and show me his promises for me in his word.